Welcome you all to today's guest lecture on the topic India in the New Space Age. Unfortunately, today's speaker, Mr. Rohan Ganpati, couldn't join because he and his mother have been found positive for COVID-19 today morning itself. But we have the other well-known personality from Bellatrix Aerospace, that is Yashas Karnam. Before I formally introduce the speaker, I would first like to invite Dr. Nandakishore, Head in Charge, Department of Geopolitics and International Relations, MAHE, to give his welcome remarks. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Utkarsha. Good afternoon, everyone. And my special thanks to Yashas Karnam for pitching in for a scheduled lecture today. It's very unfortunate that we couldn't hear Mr. Ganapati's lecture, but we pray that they all, both of them, come out of this crisis very soon. Having said that, for the Department of Geopolitics and International Relations, from the beginning with Professor Arvind Kumar in the forefront working on space, we also very closely work with ISRO on some confidential works. It's been a very important area of research, and more so we have always thought that it is one area where India has excelled. India has shown what it could, even at a point of time when the regimes across the spectrum weren't helping us, from technological denial to everything. It is from here we have grown to a scenario where we have been launching satellites to different countries across who had denied us technology. So it's a long journey that we have taken, a humble journey, but yet we are making a formidable journey from that day to present day, whatever that we have achieved. But presently, I think India in the 21st century is looking for expanding its potential. There is such huge potential, though there are also limitations that are associated. But on the potential side, there is a lot more that India could achieve. And also, India's aspirations to be a great power cannot be fulfilled without keeping space as one of the very important interventions. Now, we also happen to science and technology in geopolitics. There are also a few other ones in which we also teach defense and intelligence in India's national security. In many of them, invariably, space comes as a very important component. Even in diplomacy side, we have seen how India has launched the South Asian satellite for reconnaissance, for weather and many other things. On many fronts, I think we as Department of Geopolitics and International Relations, since the inception of the department as a teaching department in 2010, we have been trying to instill science and technology as a very important component. As part of it, several people, including the ISRO former chairmen, and many of them have spoken. Dr. Rajan has been one of the key personalities who have been interacting with the Department of Geopolitics, from looking into the dissertations of our students to helping us grow better, understand the world better in the space era. Lot of things we have been trying to do in our modest way. I think today's exercise is also essentially an extension of such activity. And this initiative is also quite special to us because one of our PhD student, Ms. Utkarsha Mahajan, who happened to speak in the beginning, she took this initiative. She walked up to me and requested if we could have a lecture, because her own PhD is revolving around the space component. And also we have another PhD student in the department who's also working on space. So we have two components in both of their PhDs. One is looking on strategic capabilities. The other one is looking on the diplomacy part of it. So from that perspective also, it is very important for her. So gave opportunity for her to go ahead and then come up with any initiative that's academic and then it's helpful for the student community. So it's an outcome of such initiative today that we are seeing as a reality with Mr. Yashas Karnam being here. So my special thanks to you, Mr. Yashas, and welcome to the Department of Geopolitics and International Relations. We wish to have a longer collaboration with you in various ways that we can as a Department of Geopolitics. As you are aware, if science and technology along with strategy can come together, I don't think there is anything better than that. Now, having said that, my thanks to you for accepting to pitch in rather than cancelling today's talk, which is very, very important for us. And I thank all my colleagues. My special thanks to Ms. Utkarsha for taking this initiative, and all other PhD scholars, students and everyone on a Saturday. And also, it's a lockdown in several places in and around. It's a lockdown.
But yet today we have had a lecture in the morning, which my colleague, my valued colleague, Dr. Monish, as a coordinator of the Northeast Study Center, had initiated. It also went well exemplarily this morning. And today afternoon, we have this one. So that just absolutely shows the enthusiasm our students are exhibiting in learning. So we wish to learn many more things from you, listening to you today. So welcome and thank you for accepting our invitation. Utkarsha, you can take over from here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Anand Kishore. That was indeed a very crisp and good overline of how space started in India and what India looks forward in terms of space. Yeah. That was a very good summary.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your words. Now I would like to invite Dr. Anand Vidyadharan, Assistant Professor, Department of Geopolitics and International Relations, MAHE, to give his introductory remarks for the session.
Thank you, Utkarsha, and thanks for taking this initiative. And thanks a lot to Mr. Yashas for coming and offering, becoming ready to offer a talk at this very last minute. It is very, really very unfortunate that Mr. Rohan would be unable to give a lecture because of the adverse health conditions. We really hope he and his family recover soon. But nevertheless, I think the topic which I think you will be talking about is something which is very relevant to us. In fact, one of our students, Ms. Alina, is also working on a dissertation, master's dissertation on some of these emerging new players in outer space, the private players. So in the past few years, we in the department have also been focusing. In fact, in one of our previous students, master's students, she also had done work on SpaceX. And as you know, this whole new space movement, which has generated quite a wave around the world, especially in the space industry, the role of SpaceX is emblematic and very important because it's kind of inspiring for all the private sector space companies around the world. And of course, maybe we really hope that Bellatrix can become a really important player in India's space industry, especially because we have seen that in the past year, India has basically opened the door wide open for private players to enter into, you know, some of the most crucial sectors of India's space program, right? So I would like Mr. Yashas to, we would like to hear from you, what is Bellatrix plans, how Bellatrix views this new opportunity, and what is the prospects for the private space industry in India. So we hope to learn a lot from you from this very important and emerging field, and also because a lot of us in this department are also into science and technology as well as into space affairs. So thank you, HS, once again for coming, and we wish to hear from you soon. Yes, Utkarsha, we can carry on.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Now I would like to formally introduce the speaker. Mr. Yashas Karnam is a co-founder of Bellatrix Aerospace, an IP-driven new space company developing advanced in-space propulsion systems. Yashas is an electrical engineer and is currently responsible for everything other than tech in the Bellatrix. His responsibilities include operations, projects, project management, business, strategy, finance, market analysis, and policy. He was also featured under the Forbes 30 Under 30 in 2018 list, I guess for Asia and India both, right? So then Yashas has also contributed a chapter on electric propulsion and the launch vehicles in the book Space India 2.0. Many of us who work on space already know about the book. It's an ORF publication, I guess. So many of us might have read it, but now we get to see it and get the first-hand experience from you also. Talking about the Bellatrix, Bellatrix Aerospace is a company which has received a developmental contract from ISRO for the supply of microwave plasma thrusters for their applications. Bellatrix was also awarded the TDB National Award 2017 from the Honorable President of India for the development of technology with a potential for commercialization. It has also received the National Startup Award 2020 under the space category. The company has also raised a fund of $3 million from Indian investors to support development and space qualifications for its propulsion systems. I guess one of the well-known investors that they have now is Deepika Padukone. I read about that in a news article. Now, coming back to you, Yashas, we would first like to initially know from you about your experience with ISRO. Then, as a part of India's emerging space ecosystem with the private players, how do you see the trajectory? And we would also like to know from your interactions with the global players, how do you see India being a part of it? Over to you, Yashas. Then we can take a Q&A session later.
Sure. Thanks a lot for the professors giving the initial remarks, and to you, Kasha, for actually enthusiastically hosting and coordinating and getting this thing together. Really a pleasure to be on this platform. In fact, I think I had come to Manipal and attended one of the sessions when we were just starting out. So probably in 2015, when we were a startup, I think we had come there to meet Dr. Satish Reddy, who was there, I think, as a chief guest for one of the programs organized by your session. I think, I mean, it's my pleasure to be part of this panel today, actually saying. About Bellatrix, I think we started as a student startup, and we started work on a project while we were in college. I was in my first year, Rohan was in his third year studying engineering, and this was probably in 2012 when we started out. In 2015, we had a ready product and a new technology developed at Bellatrix, and then we decided, instead of just letting it go, it was a new product and it was something very new for India. And we decided we will take it up as a commercial venture, because there was a lot of commercial or business interests or business advantages we had. Our products were much better than what we see globally. And that was the idea and thought process of starting up. One thing we were actually scared when we started out was we were venturing into a new area where there is no industry in the country getting into this kind of field, right? When we started out, we were the only company specializing in propulsion. And even today, when it comes to electric propulsion, we are the only company after 6 years to be working on this kind of technology, because these are very complex technologies, deeply physics intensive, and a lot of private companies do not tend to get take up investments in this sector, build a product that works in space. Second thing was also on the knowledge part, where you do not have any resources that you can readily refer and replicate and redo the same things, because these are all dual use technologies where there are defense implications and commercial space implications. Normally, publications are very limited and you cannot always believe the kind of publications. And that is where ISRO came in as a supporting stone for us when we started out. 2016, when we had just started and it was about 1 year, we had developed this one product. And fortunately, we got a chance to meet Chairman ISRO, and they were very excited that a private company is doing something like this, and ISRO decided to support us. And after that, it's been a very good journey. We have been working with ISRO for the last 5 years, and even today, it was a first of its kind contract that ISRO gave out. Normally, when you look at ISRO, what they do is they are going to develop technology and build certain products, and they're going to outsource the technology or IP to a private industry who is going to just manufacture it as per ISRO's design or ISRO's requirement. It's a part to build order, and then they are going to supply back to ISRO. That's how ISRO has been working. And whenever there is a tech transfer, if you're studying about space, you would have seen India has a strong collaboration and relationship with countries like France and Russia, from where they have taken some critical technologies like rocket engines or propulsion systems. So these are the only outbound collaborations where they involve at a technology level. But in case of Bellatrix, it was a benchmark order for ISRO also, because it was the first time where Bellatrix got a contract to develop a complete propulsion system for a satellite, which is a very major system. Among the five critical subsystems that go into a satellite, propulsion is one major system, very critical, and always risky to deal with propulsion systems. It's always dangerous, hazardous, and also prone to failures. So with all that, they did a lot of assessment and gave us the contract. And after we got the contract with ISRO, it's been a very smooth journey where we have been learning a lot about space qualification and the complexities of it. When you build a system here, you can always have the leverage that you can sell out into the market, and if there is any problem with the system, you can go and service it or replace it, right? If you are sending something on a spacecraft, you can never get a service person to go and repair something, because these are orders which cost you between like 4-5 million, including the launch cost as a starting price. And then they go all the way up to like 250, 300 million per satellite. So the amount of risk that you can take is like 0.0001%. So the idea of building anything to space, you need to perfect everything. And that is something we have been learning from ISRO. And to answer the question regarding India and global companies, I would like to put in two kinds of perspectives here. One is in terms of the limitation in terms of the knowledge available in India. That is a major roadblock for an Indian company to come into the space domain and take it up. And I think nowadays it is picking up with more and more space tech companies coming up in the last 4-5 years. And companies like us are trying to build these kind of technologies, experiment and take the risk on ourselves. But otherwise, the main challenges with respect to the availability of technology. In India, only ISRO has access to these kinds of technologies. And normally it's still closed door and we cannot get direct access to what ISRO has built. So we'll have to like invest our own money and build all this. And anything in space tech is always capital intensive. So it's a sinkhole for money. More money you spend into capital assets or R&D materials, research and all that, it becomes more stringent and more cost consuming and time consuming than academic research, because you're perfecting a product. So all that risk comes in, and that is where Indian companies also face a roadblock, and a lot more impetus needs to be given, and more people must come in, more investments must come in. And secondly, in terms of the quality of products that we are building, with the help of industry that ISRO has built over the last few decades, right? From the time ISRO started outsourcing, lot of industries, probably around 500 plus industries, work with ISRO on a regular basis. They are making their bread and butter with ISRO or DRDO. And because these systems are again flying to space, all these companies have got the capability now to build products that are like worthy of flying on space. So that ecosystem part of it is already there in India. And the advantage we have from India is in terms of the cost. So because our salaries are maybe like 6 times lesser than what you would pay in US or Europe, that is one major advantage. And this is not one industry where still automation has been like a main thing and everything can be automated. So many things are custom made in this kind of industry. So that is slowly changing, but still it would take time. So here we do have an edge. And secondly, in terms of the tech we are building, since we are all building new tech, so we are trying to build in innovations and trying to build better tech at a better price. So that will be an advantage. So once we prove our capability and build a solid product and offer it at a very good price, I'm sure that Indian private companies will have a very good scope globally in terms of getting the global market, doing much better than the global companies, and giving a better bang for the buck for the end customer. So that is where we look at it, because currently with ISRO taking up only around 2% of the total $450 billion global space industry, I think more private people need to come up and take that 2% to 10%. So that is going to be a part of India's $5 trillion economy plan that the government is looking at. So I hope that answers the question, Utkarsha.
Yes. Now I would like to like the students to join in for asking their questions and interacting with Yashas. When you can raise your hands in the comment section, in the section. Alina? Yeah, Alina, you can unmute yourself. Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Okay. So first of all, thank you, Utkarsha, for arranging this wonderful talk. And I have one question, actually. this you talked about the new policy ecosystem in India, and recently we have been in the Indian government, they implemented the in-space policy framework, which will be more beneficial for the growth of private players in the Indian space industry. So I like right now, just now you mentioned how the new private players should come up so that the Indian, the contribution made by the private space players will actually increase. So being one of the being the part of this private space players in India, how do you see this in space regulatory framework as such? Like, is it actually more beneficial? Like, what are the parts which are like constraining the growth, or like, is it constraining the growth of private actors, or is it like a solid framework which will enable the growth of Indian space industry as a whole? Like, can you put give more insights into that?
Right. So I think I've been looking at the Indian space industry for like 7-8 years, from the time just before we started the company till now. We have been looking at policies. We have also been strongly advocating and pushing through forums wherever possible on bringing a space policy in India, because it's the right way for India to go forward. And from what I can see over the years, how things have been changing, I think for the last 1.5 years, the last 1 year after the finance minister announced about this whole thing of allowing private companies to come in and have an equal playing field with ISRO and opening this in space and all that, right? I think everything that we are hearing is very positive. And in fact, all the older players like us who were in the industry, we ourselves have been shocked by the fact that so many things have been considered, because we have been attending a lot of forums and shouting out these kind of points and thing for many years, but we had not seen anything come out solidly. And now we realize that they have been taking feedback and internally conceptualizing, revising. That's a very good thing. And normally from governments, that is very hard to expect on the policy side, that you come up with a very good policy in the beginning. So from what I see from all the announcements that are out there so far, it looks very positive. And it's not that we were in fact expecting that the government would just give us permission so that we can be by ourselves and conduct business. Rather, it is more like, we are going to give you permission. We are also going to open up ISRO's facilities, give you more support. Government is going to talk about space companies and create that kind of awareness. So all that is in the right direction. And in terms of making it tougher, that is something we will have to see whether it is going to make it really very beneficial or more tough when we get into the details, because the policy has not yet been, the final version of policy has not yet been out. There have been drafts and there have been suggestions given on the drafts, and the final policy always like is the final one that helps us decide whether it's a good one or not. So that is likely to come out soon.
Thank you so much for that. I have a follow-up question also. Can I go ahead?
Yeah.
Okay. So when it comes to the private space players, again, when you take consideration like countries like United States, there are like different types of private space players, like who are solely involved with the defense part sector, and then those who are involved with the commercial sector and all. And Indian space industry has so far, which has been taken up predominantly by the government initiatives, now is opening up. And I've been following some debates where they were actually keen to look into what the Indian space industry is going to be with this partnership that is going to happen with the private sector. So my question is, do you think that in future, like just how United States have, like there is a section of or a differentiation between the, you know, the private actors who will be involved with the defense activities of the Indian space industry, and then the private actors like relating to the commercial activities, like will there be a differentiation in further in the coming years or so?
If you look at US, right, I'm not talking about like pure defense companies like Raytheon or something, but companies which are doing space tech, they have been doing, I think, mostly both defense and space. Northrop Grumman, for example, is a defense company, but they have also taken up some commercial contracts, acquired commercial companies, which are also doing commercial activities. Same way with Boeing. Boeing is building commercial satellites, Boeing is building military satellites. So from what we are seeing, companies which are commercial are also taking a military route. And I think their majority of the money is also coming immediately, at least for now, from the military ones, whereas the commercial ones are picking up and taking some pace. The majority of quantum of funding is coming from defense. I think it will be similar for all countries with an active space program and an active defense program. Here also it could be similar, but I think it will depend on the company's stance, whether they need to just focus on the defense market or whether they need to completely phase out the defense market and only look at the commercial market. Bellatrix, for example, currently is more focused on the commercial market because it's a more global market, and we have several advantages compared to competitors worldwide, so we are trying to target that. Of course, but later when there are some defense interests, we may or may not consider. So it's mostly like that. So it is very specific. That is the kind of answer that I would leave for this.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Alina. Any other question? I guess Malvika had one question. She had raised her hand. Malvika, would you like to ask the question?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Okay, I actually wanted to ask about the kind of contributions that we as IR students, as people who are into core humanities, can make to the field, either privately or in tandem with the government.
That's a good question. I think for any ecosystem to come up, or for any industry to first of all mature, and you need to get solid revenue for the country from an industry, it needs to have a strong ecosystem. The ecosystem actually comprises of many things, not just the industry. There will be the industry players, and then there will be all the subsystem manufacturers around it. And then more importantly, there will also be legal and policy people who are going to understand, look at where the country is standing, what the country requires, what other countries are doing, maybe look at policies from other countries in Europe or US, see some of the benefits that such kind companies are enjoying there. Look at grants, and based on that, constantly come up at different models. And these models can be like not just for the government. One is on an ecosystem, you can help the government and come up with new grants and make suggestions as a forum, try to improve on the industry. And secondly, even within companies, you can look at strategies behind contracts. The geopolitics behind contracts. For example, US, if I have to be a US company, there are constraints on being a propulsion system company or a rocket company in US. There is something called ITAR, you may be aware of it, International Traffic in Arms Regulation. And because you are a propulsion company and there is ITAR regulation in the US, such companies cannot easily sell their products outside the US, even if it is Europe or India or whatever country it is. So such regulations locally come in everywhere. And India also have something called SCOMET that is in place in India. And based on that, we'll have to map and look at geopolitics for companies. It is a strategic position in companies where there is an internal legal team which looks at all these kinds of relationships and enables sales. That is something where I see a group like this can really contribute.
Yes, Ashish. Any other question? If not, Yashas, I have a small question regarding you mentioned about the propulsion techniques that you have been building right now. One thing is that I would like to know about the types of mechanisms that you have been building, because I guess there are different types. One is for the orbit raising and other is satellite propulsion within the orbit, right? So what is the advantage that you think that the electric propulsion can have for India to leverage it at the diplomacy level as well as commercially? So what has been your vision for that? So I would like to know that in more details.
Okay. So here, let me clarify this. Orbit raising is again part of satellite propulsion. because it's a less understood area. I think it is often confused with rockets and satellite propulsion. When I say what we are currently building at Bellatrix, we are focused on four different technologies for propelling satellites to different orbits. So the idea is that Bellatrix started out with an integrated thruster development program. Like how big agencies like ISRO, DRDO all started out parallel projects. We took a very similar route day one when we started out, and we started developing four different products so that we have capabilities to address the entire gamut of satellite requirements. So if there is a customer who is coming up to us with a 5 kg satellite, we have a propulsion system or thruster to fit on the 5 kg satellite and that limited power. And then if there is a customer coming with a 10-ton class satellite, our biggest in the class, we still have a propulsion system to meet that. So we have now with four different technologies, we have capabilities to meet the entire range of industries. And here in satellite propulsion, there are basically two types of propulsions. One is called chemical propulsion and another is called electric propulsion. Chemical propulsion is like a mini version of a rocket sitting inside a satellite. It is like a mini tank, mini combustor, and the same combustion happens, flames come out, and it pushes the satellite, it thrusts the satellite, and that helps in raising orbit of the satellite. So that is the orbit raising parts. Maybe a rocket leaves a satellite in some orbit like 400 kilometer, and the satellite needs to go all the way up to maybe like 35,000 kilometers. So from 400 kilometer to 35,000, rocket does not take it. Satellite uses its own engine to get there. That is where it is used. One way is chemical, it is like a rocket. And then there is a second type, which is called electric propulsion. Electric propulsion is a new technology which is coming up, which is much more fuel efficient. I would rather compare it like our normal petrol bikes and electric bikes that we are currently seeing here. So in terms of efficiency, it is more efficient and more cost effective is the advantage of electric. Here, what we do is anyway, electricity is available on satellites through solar panels, you anyway store them. You convert that electricity into a state of plasma, and then you accelerate that hot plasma out of the propulsion system at extremely high velocities. And handling plasma itself is the challenging tech here. So these plasmas are like 11,000 Kelvin, which is like twice as hot as the sun's temperature. So your physics and your engineering should be so strong that there is no failure out there. So that is where we also excel and specialize in. And with that, there are two different electric and chemical propulsion, where Bellatrix has two products in electric propulsion and two products in chemical. In chemical, where we kind of stand out is we come with greener alternatives compared to traditional systems, which are even more better performing than the conventional systems. So we have greener chemical propulsion systems. And with all these products, looking at the national roadmap, roadmap for the country, there we look at several applications. One is in civilian applications where using electric propulsion instead of chemical propulsion, the cost of all satellite services that we are paying for, maybe the cost of data we are paying for to a Airtel or a Reliance or something, or maybe all the DTH services, the imaging services, whatever we are doing, eventually when the satellite cost comes down, we'll be able to meet more demand, reach out to the more rural areas without increment in cost. So even when the people are going out there, we can maintain the same cost and still meet more requirements. And eventually, over a period of time, even the cost that we are paying for these kinds of services will eventually come down when there is more capacity in satellites and when there are efficient technologies which can make satellite technology more cost effective. That is the vision also with which we have been working at Bellatrix. And secondly, in future, if there are like any defense applications, this technology can be used for our civilian security applications as well. I hope that answers.
Yes, yes. Yes, thank you, Yashas. I actually have a small question. I come from an electronics background. So there we have studied the Moore's law, if you know. So the number of circuits or integrated circuit doubles every 2 years and the cost goes down. So how do you see the space sector and the satellite, the technologies having the rise? If you can just bifurcate in terms of like how do you see the propulsion mechanisms, the development in terms of propulsion mechanisms as well as the satellite design, because now we have the different types of satellites within the means like CubeSats or NanoSats or PicoSats that are coming up, and the number of launches will be higher, and number of satellites that will be going number of satellites in the payload will be higher for every per launch. So correct. how do you see the India's commercial space sector standing that race, and what the Indian technology specifically, what will be the USP of the technology? How do you see that?
Right. So Moore's law does not apply here directly because we are not working with circuits. But of course, in terms of satellites, how it is working, I'll just give you a context why satellites were bigger and how the trend is going on. So originally, satellites were built by governments. For example, NASA was building it, European Space Agency and the respective country space programs were all building it. Indian Space Research Organization was building it. Whenever bigger countries, like countries themselves invest in satellites, you normally have a lot of bandwidth in terms of the amount of money you can invest on a satellite program. So it started out there, and eventually government started transferring technology to major players like Airbus, Boeing, and these kinds of big players started taking up the roles of lead integrators or tier one suppliers to build and contract these satellites for the government agencies. And back then, when all the satellite building started, technology was very obsolete. So here in our mobile phones, if we are having a most advanced Snapdragon processor, probably the satellite technology is maybe like about 5 to 10 years older technology that we still use in satellites. We don't have some of the most latest tech. But even then, even with slightly older tech, we use older tech because there are some limitations in terms of architectures that you need to go in to ensure that all the components are radiation hardened. In space, you experience very harsh radiations and temperatures. So temperatures may be like plus 120 on one side of the satellite and minus 120 on the other side. And with such temperatures and like different varying solar cycles, different atmospheres, different magnetic fields, you get a lot of radiation. To get some systems with that kind of radiation protection, it's always the technology is slightly behind where we are in terms of the commercial applications. And keep considering all these discounting as well, the satellite technology has come down significantly in terms of size. The size of components have actually come down because from where we were with room sized computers, we have come to our smart watches having capable of the room sized computers. So with all that, similarly satellite tech is coming down. And what is happening, instead of building one big satellite at such huge investments, now the trend has changed and something called new space has come in. New space started maybe around the time SpaceX started, and there have been many private companies trying to build their own space ventures. It's been going very well, and a lot of private companies are getting huge investments. Probably yearly $10+ billion have been flowing in the last 2-3 years. And with all the private funded money, what people are doing is, instead of building one big satellite which cost you $250 million, you spread your risk with the same $250 million and build a constellation of maybe around 70 to 80 satellites instead of one big satellite, and you distribute your risk. So you deploy them over time. So you look at your active customer demand. If there is demand for maybe X amount of data, you deploy 50 of the satellites. If the demand increases, you make it 60 satellites, then 70 satellites. That's how constellations are actually picking up, and they have that flexibility. And second, if one of the component fails in a very big satellite, the entire 250 million satellite is gone. Or even while you're transporting your entire big satellite after assembly, if it falls down or if there is breakage, your entire $250 million satellite is mostly gone. And that kind of risk kind of comes down with miniaturization. So similarly, the kind of applications that we are able to do from a smaller satellite is increasing. And your power required to process data, your processes are less power hungry. With that, I think smaller satellites are becoming much more capable, and that is the kind of change that is happening. Overall, in terms of where India stands in terms of technology USP, that is a very relative question to the company we are talking about. For example, there may be 50 companies in India. Of these 50 companies, maybe 5 to 10 of them may be building great technology. Other 40 people may be trying to build business models. They may be on the path to building a great product. So I think that's a very relative question. Hope that answers the question.
Yes. Yeah, we have a question from Dr. Anand Vidyadharan. Sir, please ask me.
Yeah, maybe Vineet can go first.
It's actually okay because I have three questions. So if you want to go ahead, I can come in after.
Three questions, Vineet, so you can go ahead.
Okay, sure. Okay, I'll try to keep them as short as possible. But before that,
maybe one at a time would be better.
Yeah, I will do that. First of all, let me say it's really refreshing to hear from someone who certainly has his finger on the pulse of the market, of the industry, and from a company that's going great guns. So it was really refreshing. It has been so far to listen to you. So my first question, actually, two of my questions actually are related in a sense to the business itself that Bellatrix is involved in. So the first question, if I may ask, is with respect to the Indian private ecosystem, apart from yourself, in the sense that you've spoken eloquently about the role ISRO has played in the company's rise and the collaborations you have with ISRO, but are there also in the anvil projects that you might be looking at with players such as Skyroot or even the Godrej-led consortium, which is currently going to be working on developing the PSLV and so on? Do you envision a situation in the next 5 to 10 years where these players, along with yourself, might have reached a particular level in the industry where you could be doing flagship missions on your own, irrespective of ISRO, of course, at the same time using ISRO's facilities as well? So that's question one.
Okay, that's indeed a good question, Vineet. So with respect to private ecosystem, that is something that is really picking up, and we see a very long way for the private companies to come up and do a lot of exciting stuff here on the space sector and build our own missions. In fact, Bellatrix has also collaborated with 3 Indian space companies so far. We have collaborated with Skyroot, and we have collaborated with Dhruva Space, and we have also collaborated with a company called SatSure. And what we are actually building, we have come up with a new product. It's called an orbital transportation vehicle, and I think the media has coined the term space taxi, which is more catchy out there. So what it actually does is it takes smaller, it's like a mothership satellite, which is going to take smaller satellites on top of it and kind of offer a cab service kind of thing in space. So when you go on a rocket, you always ride share, and when you are ride sharing, you take around 10 satellites might go into a single orbit, but all 10 may not necessarily need to operate in that orbit. They will have to change and all that. So with our product, what will happen is without waiting for your custom launch or without taking a very expensive dedicated micro launch vehicle, you go on a normal launch vehicle at a very good cost, and then we deploy all the 10 satellites into 10 different orbits and do that custom deployment. So for that, we are now signed up with Skyroot, where we are using their launch vehicle, and our demo mission together with Skyroot there is planned in 2023. So 2021 itself, they're in fact estimating their first launch. I don't know if it would move to 22 or something because of the rising COVID. But again, even if that happens in 22, 23, we are planning to work together on that. And secondly, with SatSure, also we are kind of trying to integrate some of their payload into a platform that we are building for the space taxi. And with that, we'll be collaborating there. Dhruva Space also, we are working together on certain projects where our propulsion systems can go into their satellites, and some of the satellite components they are building might be used for us. So this is just the starting. And we are also actively looking at opportunities with other Indian space players, also trying to collaborate, synergize, and build something together. And I think eventually this is first step where we will try out these kinds of collaborations. When this is there, there are going to be more stronger collaborations where both parties are going to invest much more capital into a joint venture kind of thing. And talking of big players like Godrej or others who are building the consortium for PSLV, we really are open, and we are actively looking at ways in which we can collaborate. So because if it's just a manufacturing contract where Godrej or somebody is getting the complete design from ISRO and just manufacturing, then that might not be of a lot of interest for Bellatrix, because we are mostly coming in where there is IP, technology development, R&D. So if it's a trivial manufacturing job, it might not really be of great interest. But if there is a lot of customization, optimization there, we can partner in as a technology partner for such a collaboration. So it kind of depends on the application. So if there is technology, we would definitely be part of such things.
All right. Thank you for that very detailed answer. I know I said three questions, but I got a follow-up question while you were talking. I'll refrain from that for now. But sorry, my second question is actually about the propulsion market and your take on the Aerojet Rocketdyne acquisition, which is underway by Lockheed Martin. Of course, Raytheon has challenged it, but you did speak about how you look at the 2 to 10% market domestically, as well as the global commercial market. And this, such an acquisition would certainly be, let's say it would ruffle the feathers across the entire propulsion industry globally. So do you see that as a challenge, or is that something that that you're not too concerned about at this particular moment in time?
See, acquisition for industry is not a challenge, basically. So acquisition is not always a forced acquisition. Most of the times it goes with mutual will. If Aerojet probably wanted to get into a contract with Northrop, or there was that will only, that would have probably moved in. So for them, it might have been good. In fact, it always happens like that. Very few cases where there will be hostile takeovers. That is like 1 in 100 cases. So, acquisitions is not a bad thing. For it depends on what the company really wants, whether the company wants to stay as themselves and grow bigger, expand their wings, get into different areas and still continue with their own brand name, or maybe over a period of time get acquired by a big industry group, which is probably into multiple sectors and investing hugely in and acquiring different companies, right? So it completely depends on the company's management decision. So getting that, coming to Aerojet Rocketdyne, I think it was a pretty neutral deal. They have been in the market for some time and they have got that deal at like a 3x of their annual revenue, which is like trivial. It is quite okay kind of a deal. And overall propulsion, the market we are seeing is not just because there is one acquisition. We are betting more on the upcoming satellites that are coming up, because several tens of thousands of satellites are going to be launched in the next few years. And if so many satellites are getting launched, there is also going to be a greater risk of space debris colliding and satellites colliding into each other, and also space situational awareness, which would be required. And once all this monitoring, strong space traffic monitoring system would eventually come into place, it has concerns have started now that I think Starlink, OneWeb and these kinds of constellations are getting deployed. But eventually, once there would be like one collision or something, it will become a very serious problem or concern that the industry would look at very seriously. And once these kinds of things come in, propulsion becomes mandatory. Already, I think FCC in US has said that before you get a license to launch a satellite, you need to have a provision to like deorbit it at end of the life, which indirectly hints that you need to have a propulsion system on board. The draft of India Space Policy, which also came up in 2018 or something, even that had a clause saying that all satellites need to carry their own propulsion systems to deorbit them at end of life. So these are going to be essential, and that is the market that we are really betting on.
Thank you. And very interestingly, that actually leads to my final question, because we actually here at the department have a project. It's a monthly newsletter that we do for ISRO headquarters. And so essentially we keep a check on strategic events in the space sector, which take place in the major spacefaring nations, including India, of course. And one of the constant issues that we keep coming back to, or we keep writing articles on, is the debris issue. And for me particularly, I'm doing my PhD on space security issues, actually looking at possibility of cooperation among the major spacefaring nations on space security. And it's been a for the last few months, I've been looking at this particular question of space security cooperation from the point of view of stakeholders in space. The nation states which have the number of deployed satellites in the various orbits, the threats to them as well. And increasingly you're seeing, because you mentioned the mega constellations which are coming out, very soon you're going to have the largest nation state in terms of satellites, the USA, being overtaken by one of its own private companies in terms of deployed space assets. And it's not just SpaceX, it's going to be Boeing soon, or it's going to be OneWeb is already there, and many more.
So Bezos is also betting big on it.
Exactly, yes. So when this situation, well, it's already becoming a reality, but yeah, let's say in the next 2 years or so, the increasing stake that private companies will have, particularly in the low Earth to middle Earth orbits, where we are largely talking about space debris mitigation in at least in the immediate run, as well as the fact that a lot of the companies which are actually working on space debris removal or mitigation technologies like yourself with propulsion, are private entities. I mean, they may have some level of collaboration with national agencies, but they're private entities from astroscale right down to hundreds of them. And Space Tug, the Space Taxi or Space Tug, as the Americans call it, with Momentus and Space Logistics and so on. Again, similar ideas of looking, or rather different ideas looking at tackling the space debris program removal challenge. Now, my question at the end of all this is, at the moment, whether you have the discussions on Paros at the conference on disarmament, or whether it's a UNGA, or whether it's the UNOSA for that matter as well, it's almost entirely a state-driven, a nation-driven affair. But with the increasing stake of private players in outer space, do you... what would you be expecting in terms of having a say in how space policy, you mentioned space traffic management and all these policies which would be coming not just in India, but also globally in the coming years. How much of a stake do you expect in framing those policies or having a say at least with respect to those national as well as international policies?
I've been thinking about this personally also. I'm genuinely concerned actually on the space policy stuff. I mean, the space debris stuff that you just mentioned about. So what I personally feel is probably if there are one or two collisions that might happen in space, right? That is when the time everybody is going to start talking about it, make it a very big issue. I mean, a very serious thing, and probably a globalized forum might come in, maybe the Space Policy Institute that is currently the Outer Space Treaty kind of treaties that are coming up, right, where different countries are collaborating and bringing in policies. I feel something like that might come in, and it might still have all industry stakeholders also voicing in their opinions. But I mean, that is something that I feel would be an ideal way to do it. I really don't know. The time will tell how it's going to be taken up. But I think it is going to get very, very serious if there are one or two instances of collision. And at the moment, it is not still very serious because there are like few thousands of satellites in probably a orbit which is orders, I mean, much bigger than Earth, because this is Earth is probably this small and you are in this orbit, which makes your orbit much bigger than Earth. In such a huge space, there are few thousands of satellites. But if one, two collisions happen, I think we are in serious trouble, because after like a few number of collisions, you can't stop it. It becomes chain reaction. And once that chain reaction starts, your entire satellite framework may go down and the entire Earth may go out of technology. Right? That is where it's going to live. I mean, your every single office is going to stop. Every single technology that we are using, your phones, internet, literally our life of the 20th century is going to stop if that happens. It's a major threat.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
So Utkarsha, then I'll ask the questions.
Yes, sir.
Actually speaking, some of my questions already was asked by Vineet. So I think I got my answers. But nevertheless, Just I wanted to get Litt's views on two things. One is on Bellatrix future plans in terms of, you know, are you just going to stick on to this electric propulsion, or are you having some plans as of now on expanding into other domains in the space industry? And also, I would also like to get his views on how competitive is this field, especially electric propulsion, not especially in India as such, because obviously that unique position of Bellatrix, but outside. I'm talking about in the global competition context. And secondly, I wanted to know about what his views are about, you know, SpaceX based, or Elon Musk, for instance, basically challenging international law when he said that, you know, in Mars, when we are not going to obey any of the international laws back on Earth. So being a company, obviously, certainly must have inspired by SpaceX, but are you also inspired by this particular statement of his? Thank you.
So with going one by one, starting with Bellatrix, I think we have already had like four different products in propulsion, as I was mentioning earlier. Two of them in chemical propulsion systems, which are green chemical propulsion systems, and two of them in electric propulsion systems. And after this, the next logical evolution for us is to get on to building some very unconventional satellite platforms where the mission life and the mission design corely is influenced by the kind of propulsion systems you have. So we are taking up some challenging tasks and building certain propulsion system, certain satellite platforms which are quite challenging and unconventional and propulsion focused. So that is something we are looking at. And secondly, the space taxi is also one thing in the radar for Bellatrix, and we have already deployed teams, and teams have already started work on building our own space taxi with, I mean, a great combination of propulsion systems and other technologies, which kind of helps it get positioned in a very unique way out there. So, and going forward, I think we will keep innovating, keep looking out for technology which probably falls within our expertise or within our reach and where the industry is heading towards. So any new promising technology which we are capable of, we will continue to innovate and get there. And I guess the second, probably the third question was on SpaceX. Could you repeat the second question, please?
No, it was basically about the competitors, the competitive market. Yeah, global, at the global level.
So I can tell, I cannot answer for all industries in general. Maybe for Bellatrix, I can tell you with all our propulsion systems, the USP we are having is we are trying, I mean, our products are kind of best in class in terms of performance and efficiency. So we have four products. All four products with respect to competition of their respective sectors worldwide, we are building, we're giving the best product at the best price. And there are also various new innovations that have made systems more redundant and more reliable. So these things are something that we offer in terms of being competitive. So in the market, only two major things are there. Is the product really good? Is it better than what is there? And is it priced better? So we are ticking both the boxes out there. And lastly, on the SpaceX Mars thing, I think it'll take us some time to get there and for people to evolve such policies, right? So it also is important for the first person going out there for the planet to set his first set of rules. I would partially agree, partially disagree. It is not that we cannot throw away every framework on Earth, but practically think about it. You are building a program, or even you may be a government agency or a private company, right? If you are taking on an exploration mission and going to a planet and you are going to operate everything, no government is helping you financially or legally or anything like that. Nobody has personal motivation to sit and do a framework that is going to help you. And secondly, they are not sitting with you in designing the entire framework. It is like if that happens, when that happens with respect to mass colonization that Elon is talking about, if it really happens, he needs to get a few thousand people working on it, designing the entire infrastructure. And if you wait for somebody here to some government to say, set me up a rules for Mars, the technologies he's building or the safety precautions he's building, the travel he's planning out, all those kinds of things would only be known for his company, right? The government guy who is setting up the policy would never know it. So the person setting up the policy should have a very sound knowledge of what they're building for. But I think by the time it comes up, of course, people and government also would take it more seriously when you know that these things are happening and somebody is actually getting there to space. I think by that time, government would intervene and probably together they might come up with a policy, taking technical inputs from maybe a SpaceX and legal inputs from all the things that is out there. Probably that is what I feel. Only time will tell.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Anybody, any other question? Okay. Thank you, Yashas. I just would like to give a formal vote of thanks before we close the session. I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Yashas for coming in to interact with our students and us and making this event fruitful kind of conversation and the interaction and enlightening us on the topic. I would also like to express my sincere gratitude to our HOD, Dr. Nandakishore sir, for encouraging me and facilitating this talk, and also Dr. Anand Vidyadharan for encouraging and supporting me when I was trying to organize and coordinate the event. And last but not the least, thank you to all the participants who asked the questions and everybody who attended the session for making this event a grand success. Thank you all.
Thank you. It was really a pleasure interacting. Very good set of questions. Thanks.
Thank you, SS.
Thank you.